Hello, this is the background lecture for lab assignment number 9. The related lectures are 25 through 28, and the written materials are in sections 2.7.0 through 2.8.0. The goals of this lab assignment are to familiarize ourselves with steady-state sinusoidal circuit analysis and, specifically, circuit measurements of steady-state sinusoidal signals. So we're going to use the waveform generator to apply sinusoidal inputs to a couple of simple circuits, and then we'll use the oscilloscope to measure the resulting sinusoidal voltages and currents. Now I want to emphasize that oscilloscopes do not measure current. However, you can measure two voltages from that voltage difference across a known resistance. You can infer the current. Now, most oscilloscopes have built-in math functions. At the very least, you should be able to take the difference between two voltages. The EE board has some more advanced math functions in which you can take a difference between two voltages and divide that by an arbitrary number. Now, that will allow you to directly display on the screen the current through a known resistance. Now, we'll also use the measured sinusoidal signals to estimate the gain and the phase of the circuit. And we will, in the final part of the lab assignment, estimate impedance from measured voltages and currents. In part one of this lab assignment, we'll look at a simple series RL circuit. Now, the circuit shown here to the right on this slide has two voltages indicated, V sub R of T, a voltage across the resistor, and V sub L of T, a voltage across the inductor. Now, the overall voltage applied to the circuit is Vin of T. That results in a current into the RL series combination of In of T. We want to characterize this circuit with a frequency response, H of J omega. So at some particular frequency omega, H of J omega is the current In over the voltage Vn. So this particular format of the frequency response implies that the voltage input, Vn, is the input, and the current into the circuit, In, is the output. Remember, the frequency response is output divided by input in phasor form. So we're going to test this circuit, compare our measurements with our analytical predictions. In order to test the circuit and make this comparison, we're going to have to measure gain and measure a phase difference between the applied voltage and the resulting current. Now, I want to emphasize a few things about the measurement of a sinusoidal or time-varying current. We need to measure sinusoidal voltages and currents in order to get a gain and a phase for part one. Oscilloscopes in general do not provide the ability to measure current directly. However, you have multiple channels on your oscilloscope. You can measure two voltages on either side of a known resistance. From that voltage difference and the resistance and Ohm's law, you can infer the current through the resistor. Now, most oscilloscopes have some level of math functions built in that can streamline this process. I'll demonstrate this when we wire up the circuit and make some measurements and demonstrate the working of lab assignment number 9. Now let's demonstrate the operation of the circuit and some of the math functions that will let us infer the current more easily. This is our series combination of a resistor and an inductor. We're applying a voltage from the arbitrary waveform generator, I'm using channel 1, to this terminal of the resistor. The resistor connects to the inductor. The inductor's other terminal goes to ground. So I'm putting a voltage between these two terminals. I need to measure the voltage here and the voltage here to give me the current across the resistor. So this voltage minus this voltage divided by this resistance is going to be the current into the device. This voltage here, which I'm measuring directly, is going to be the applied voltage. Now let's take a look at these two voltages on the oscilloscope. For a fairly low frequency, and at the moment I have about 1.1 kilohertz, remember the inductor is looking like a short circuit at low frequencies. So my inductor voltage, which is the blue line, is a low value. The overall voltage being applied is this orange line. It's relatively high. Now, if I increase this frequency, I should get more voltage across the inductor so that there's less and less voltage drop across the resistor. That should imply that the current going into the resistor is going down as frequency goes up. Now let me demonstrate the use of the math function to infer the current. Down here, I can add math. Let me do a custom version. I don't need M1. M2, if I click down here, will be a green line on my screen. I want to take channel 1 minus channel 2. I'm not using the same resistance that you're supposed to use in your lab. I believe I'm using a 67 ohm resistor, so my current is going to be the differences in these voltages, so channel 1 minus channel 2 divided by 67 ohms. Let me apply that. Now the green line is my current. Notice that it's very small. The current through this is going to be on the order of tens of milliamps. Let me change this range to maybe 20 millivolts per division. Now I want to point out that this is listed as being in millivolts. You need to keep track of the fact that this is actually milliamps. The oscilloscope window doesn't know what math you're doing. Okay, you have to apply your own units. Now we can see the voltage input and the current input. We can measure a gain difference and we can measure a phase difference between the applied voltage and the resulting current. Now in this lab assignment, we'll have to estimate the gain from two measured sinusoids. This slide gives us some idea of how to do that. If we have two sinusoids, the peak amplitude of the input is delta V in, the peak amplitude of the output is delta V out. The gain of this circuit is just delta V out over delta V in, the output peak value over the input peak value, assuming that everything has a zero DC level. Estimating phase requires us to measure a time difference between the output and the input. On this particular slide, delta T is the time difference by which the output has been shifted from the input. It's the time distance between successive peaks on the output and the input. Now, the peak-to-peak time, capital T on this slide, is the period of both of the sinusoids. Remember, the output and the input have to share the same frequency if it's a linear circuit, so capital T is the period of either the output or the input. Capital T, one period, corresponds to 360 degrees of phase shift. Therefore, the phase shift associated with delta T is the ratio of delta T to capital T times 360. These slides on measuring gain and measuring phase are also provided in the appendix to this lab assignment with some written words associated with them if you need to review this. In part two of this lab assignment, we are looking at a series RC circuit and estimating the input impedance of this circuit from voltage and current measurements. Remember that impedance is the ratio of voltage to current. So the input impedance for this particular circuit is the ratio of the phasor representing Vn of t to the phasor representing In of t. Now remember that for this particular circuit, and in general for any circuit which contains an energy storage element, the impedance will be a function of frequency. So what we're going to do is make measurements of voltage and current for three different frequencies. We will estimate three different impedances and note that that impedance changes with frequency. Now we're going to first estimate what the impedances should be from nominal values, then we'll make our measurements and compare those to our expected values. The test procedures for this RC circuit are similar to the previous test procedures for the RL circuit. I won't do any demonstrations associated with this circuit.